We all know the world is in trouble.
We're facing a man-made disaster of global scale.
And we keep being told how to fix it. But getting rid of plastic straws or flying less isn't going to be enough. There's a bigger culprit that hardly anyone is talking about. The food industry is destroying the living world, and it appears to be insatiable. But the good news is that there could be a way out of this mess. This film is about revolutionary ideas that could do away with agriculture as we know it, but still feed 10 billion people and restore the natural world to create something extraordinary. Agriculture today is by far the biggest driver of global deforestation.
We need to absorb carbon from the atmosphere, and the trees are the natural carbon sponges that exist all around us.
So, broadly speaking, this is a stick of wet carbon.
Yes, about 40% of this tree is carbon, the rest is water. And more than that, when the tree sheds its leaves, that carbon goes to the soil. So if we look beneath this tree, what we find is this absolutely gorgeous, black, humic soil that's rich in carbon. There's probably as much carbon in the soil here as in this trunk.
When carbon-absorbing trees are destroyed, and the soil around them ploughed, greenhouse gases that have been locked away for centuries are released into the atmosphere. When you take into account the forests and other ecosystems that would grow on land used by livestock, scientists estimate that the carbon cost of just 4 kilograms of beef is equivalent to taking a flight from London to New York and back again. So why do we allow this destructive cycle to continue? I think it's because of the stories we're told.
It's amazing how many of the books that we read in earliest childhood have the same theme. It's all about a farm, but it's not really a farm that bears much relationship to the farms I see these days. It's a farm with one pig and one sheep and one cow and one horse and one dog and one chicken, and they're all living together in perfect harmony. There's no discussion about why the animals might be on the farm or what's going to happen to the animals that are on the farm. It's this bucolic idyll which we all grow up with, and we all come to believe as children that this is what farming really is. And it takes quite a lot to unsee that, to recognize that actually something rather different is going on in the countryside.
I don't blame any farmer for being wary of a vegan on a mission. My biggest problem with livestock farming is how inefficient it is. We keep being told we should switch to free-range meat, as it's meant to be more environmentally friendly. But the surprising truth is that it causes more damage to the living world than indoor livestock farming, because it uses much more land, mostly for pasture. And even that pasture may not be enough to support the animals. Abby's dairy cattle eat more grass and cereals than she can grow, so she has to supplement their diet with imports. It's true that this animal feed isn't fit to be eaten by humans, but it wouldn't have to be grown at all if it were not for animal farming. One third of the world's crops are being grown to feed to livestock. Chew on this. 90% of all the soya humans consume is embedded in fish, eggs, meat, and dairy. Behind almost every picture postcard farm is a huge, industrialized, global food chain.
I love cows. I really do. You know, it's not that got it in for the cows or for the farmers for that matter. It's just the total impact of all these operations, farm after farm after farm, nation after nation. You just can't sustain it.
But if we all go on as we are, we're going to run out of planet. There's got to be a better way to feed ourselves. Freshwater life is being wiped out by farm manure.
So this is all the poo and all the pee from the cows. Oh, I can really feel this stuff in my face. It's stinging my eyes. I can feel it in my lungs a bit.
This relentless flow of animal poo is global. In America, factory farms are producing 13 times more sewage than all the humans put together.
This is a shocking state of affairs. And you know what really gets to me? It's the double standards. We take industrial pollution seriously. But when it comes to farming, we've got a completely different attitude. Maybe one day people will come here and say, oh, you know, this river, it used to be polluted. It used to have all these pollution events. And why was that, Daddy? Well, they had all this cow manure would come down the river. What's manure? Oh, it's poo. What's a cow? Oh, a cow. They were these animals that they used to get food out of, this sort of white stuff. Milk, you know, just like your mother's milk. They would get that out of cows and drink it. What? Oh, yes, no, that used to happen. Wow, weird. It's kind of how I'd like it to be.
Farming's assault on nature is destroying not only other species, but also our own prospects of survival. Current practices in many places treat the soil so carelessly that it's losing its capacity to support us. It's being damaged so quickly that according to the UN, we have just 60 years of harvests left. At this rate, farming won't be able to feed the growing human population. There could be 9 or 10 billion people by the middle of this century. But that's not the biggest population crisis. When people become richer, they tend to eat more meat. The number of farm animals is increasing twice as fast as the number of humans. There's just not enough land for the world to keep eating like this. If we stay on this trajectory, we could be headed for mass starvation. So what do we do? It's time to throw away our storybook view of farming and turn instead to something that looks like science fiction.
Synthetic flesh.
What if we could eat real meat, but use only a tiny amount of land to produce it? Livestock farmer Ilted Dunsford wants to replace his cows with meat he's grown from animal stem cells.
So I would be able to go to a shop and buy something which is cultured meat, and it will have come out of this room.
Yes, so cells in and we can get sausages out.
Scientists unveiled the first hamburger to be grown from stem cells in a televised stunt in 2013. This burger cost around £220,000 to make. Now, technologists are racing to develop an affordable, mass-produced version. Ilted joined that race 3 years ago after an overseas research trip revealed where his animal feed was coming from.
I traveled to the States, to Canada, to China, and all across Europe to understand all these varying systems that allow us to eat the food that we now eat. And that was a real turning point for me, especially ending that trip in the Amazon and seeing some large-scale deforestation. It was actually an emotional experience to understand my personal choices as a farmer here in Wales actually had a direct correlation with the crops that were being grown in Brazil.
Now ILTIT has teamed up with scientists from the University of Bath to try to lead the field in developing British cultured meat.
A lot of people think this is some kind of Frankenstein food which is going to destroy us in one way or another.
And I understand that. It took me a long time to get my head around it before sort of I made that leap. Anything that's alien to you is slightly scary. It may well take a few years, but it's about consumer acceptance. It's about explaining. It's about education. This is a way of allowing people to continue to eat meat as they know it, without it being of complete detriment to the planet.
Making cultured meat will almost certainly still require crops to supply protein to animal cells so they multiply. But the process will be much more efficient than feeding those plants to livestock because it grows only meat rather than the whole animal.
You put a few cow cells, then you feed them with this soup and they grow along there and basically make meat.
Yep, that's exactly it.
The product which comes out of the end, does it taste like meat?
Tastes exactly like meat, because chemically it is meat. You know, if you were to take it to a laboratory and test a piece of meat, it is exactly the same.
What's different is that this stuff can be engineered to be better than meat from animals by removing components like saturated fats, which can help to cause heart disease, cancer and obesity. In a few years, it's possible that lab-grown meat could be both cheaper and healthier than ILTIT's Welsh beef ever was.
Our culture is now very, very different from what my grandfather's culture was and actually what his diet was versus what our diet is. So we've moved forward. We need to take the emotion out of how we deal with this and just use the rational.
I couldn't agree more. Cultured meat is likely to be far better for the planet than meat from animals. But it's not perfect because it still requires land-hungry crops. What if science could do away with farming and instead make food out of thin air? Now that really could change the world. Where were we? Oh yes, hurtling towards a projected global population of 9 or 10 billion people in the next 30 years. We've discovered that existing models of agriculture are driving us towards climate breakdown. And if we keep eating like we do at the moment, they won't be able to feed everyone. For environmental reasons, I hardly ever fly. But this trip is worth it. Because what's happening in this Finnish laboratory?
Hello.
Hello, welcome.
Hello.
Could change the world.
How are you doing? Yeah, great. So this is the centre where it all happens. The
yeah, exactly. We're making food here at this very moment without agriculture. What we're doing is that we're bringing a new harvest, growing a new harvest for the humankind.
These scientists have done something remarkable.
Oh, look at this stuff. It's amazing colour, isn't it? It's golden. So does this flour count as food legally?
Not yet, no.
They've produced this flour from thin air. Jolt of electricity and bacteria. In a strictly unscientific trial, I'm one of the first people in the world to be allowed to taste it.
So this is quite a historic occasion because It's the first time you cook pancakes out of this stuff for a guest, isn't it? You cooked it once as a practice.
They tell me this powder is about 60% protein, six times more than wheat flour.
I feel like I'm in unexplored territory here. You really wouldn't know that that wasn't a conventional pancake made with eggs.
I'm sure my grandchildren will find it very odd if they find a real egg in their fridge. Grandpa, did you really steal this from a chicken?
I would eat that every morning, no trouble. That is lovely.
The plan is to mould and shape this electric protein into a huge number of different foodstuffs. It's a revolutionary idea. Growing food from microbes would do away with crops and farm animals and use only the land on which the factories would sit. Food's global footprint would be miniaturized. All this starts with just a few bacteria taken from the soil.
So from these tiny beginnings, you could feed how many people?
Any number of people, because it will start to grow and multiply.
The bacteria are fed on a diet of water, hydrogen, and carbon dioxide. All these components can be drawn from the air. Apart from that, they need only a small amount of salts.
So almost everything we eat at the moment comes originally from plants, turning sunlight into energy. And then so if we eat animals, they're eating the plants, which should turn the sunlight into energy. This is something completely different.
Yeah, we skip all of that. We think that if we want to make a fundamentally more efficient food system, we can go from electricity directly to edible calories.
They use electricity to split apart water molecules to produce the hydrogen that feeds the bacteria. The recent boom in renewable energy means that this electricity comes at a low carbon cost. Even if they use the most land-intensive renewable solar power, the team claims they could supply enough protein to feed all the world's people in an area the size of Ohio.
We can produce food in the desert, we can produce food even in the Arctic, in dark, and even in space.
Within 5 years, they want their first factory to be making electric protein as cheap as soya.
This is an extraordinary thing, producing food while bypassing the entire plant and animal kingdom. If you can produce this protein without using loads of land, without chopping down trees, without pouring filth into a river, then you've kind of closed the circle of food production. And we can have food which isn't trashing the planet, and could feed all the 9 or 10 billion people who are going to live here.
These microbes could produce all the protein, oils, and carbohydrates our bodies need without farming. They could also be the feedstock for cultured meat. That takes a massive amount of pressure off the living world. But there's something missing. For a healthy diet, we'll still need fruit and vegetables. And this introduces a new problem. Every fruit and veg farmer I've ever met, even the organic ones, uses some kind of fertilizer or manure. Every farmer except this one.
It looks to some people like the past, but I think this is the future.
Look at that.
Oh, amazing.
This is on land that's never had any manure inputs or fertilizer for 32 Beautiful. Years. So we plant one and we take 12 out. It's not a bad return.
No,
really.
It's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah.
During 3 decades growing vegetables without manure or fertilizer, Ian Tolhurst has found a way to make these 17 acres of scrappy land sing.
You can hear our soil.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
40% stone.
His technique is simple. Where others use manure and chemicals, Ian uses long-rooted weeds to draw up nutrients from deep in the ground. He then feeds them back into the topsoil as a natural fertilizer.
You can see here on the ground, this has been mown. There's so much going on in this material. It's not just a bit of dead material. Yeah. It's a living organism which feeds the soil.
And that's completely different from the standard agricultural model, which is all about bringing your nutrients in and spreading them over the land.
If you are bringing manure from another farm, you're bringing someone else's land in. They have to get their fertility from somebody else's land again, and so it goes on.
Ian brings in only one material from outside the farm.
It's just a bit of wood chip.
You see these little fungal threads? And that helps to create a relationship with the plants, which gets more nutrients to them at the right time of year.
Although this is an organic farm, its production levels are approaching conventional yields. A remarkable achievement. It's also running at a profit. Not many farms in Britain can say that at the moment. Even better, the fertility of the soil has been steadily rising. And every corner is swarming with life. Because instead of using pesticides, Ian is farming insects.
Now I can see bees, I can see a painted lady butterfly over there
There's
on the knapweed.
The more insects we have, the less we have a pest problem, because they're controlling pest problems. This is the empty case of a ladybird larvae. It will consume hundreds and hundreds of aphids every day.
So these ladybirds and the other predators come in and sweep up all those nasty black fly that would otherwise be killing your broad beans.
Correct. We need the pest to encourage the predator. We need the predator to control the pest. We need both.
Why should letting insects manage themselves seem radical? Ian's techniques are now being rapidly adopted by other farmers. I hope that before too long, they will go mainstream.
There's this sense that, well, we just work with nature, not working against nature. We don't have to be control freaks to produce a huge amount of food.
If we can produce most of our food without farming, we will have room for forests and other living systems to return, and they can draw down vast amounts of carbon dioxide as they grow. At my final port of call, governments are doing just that. This land beside the River Rhine has been turned from a dairy and maize farm into a thriving ecosystem.
Every way I look, I'm seeing something which makes my heart just go because it's so lovely. The dragonflies, the frogs, the birds, the wind in the trees, I mean, it's beautiful.
The sound of
the
poplars.
The sound of those poplars. It's almost as if they're singing.
I think everybody should come to this place to see what can happen in such a short time. Really, imagine like 25, 30 years ago, the trees were not here. The plants in the water were not here. So it all came back in a couple of decades or even less.
Astonishing.
This is not happening in some empty corner of Europe. A couple of million people live within an hour's drive in a country even more densely populated than the UK.
We didn't plant anything here. The seeds came in, birds brought the seeds. Can you imagine, in 1993, this was still maize. It was one big crop field.
It was a field of maize?
Yes.
A growing crop?
Yeah. So like biodiversity was like one plant.
This explosion of wildlife is happening because the Dutch government bought up farmland for the Rhine to pour into when it floods, protecting cities downstream.
Farmers, they shouted at us, like, we will never sell the land. And then literally a day afterwards, they would call the government, like, I want to sell my land.
Although some jobs were lost when the farms shut down, the Rewilders figures suggest five times as many have been created through ecotourism and its wider effects on the local economy.
There was a woman cycling here and I started to chat with her. And she said, well, it's like a miracle that an area like this could have been preserved for ages and that it's still like this. And I said, excuse me, madam, this is just like 5 years old, so it's brand new. And she was really like, God, really?
Fantastic. God, it's so rich. There's so much here. It's amazing.
Life is rolling back into this region. The beavers, the eagles, they're returning. Recently, and with no human intervention, wolves crossed the border from Germany and set up home nearby. If this can happen in the Netherlands, it can happen anywhere.
I've been an environmental campaigner since I was a child. And during this time, I've seen almost everything go in just one direction, which is down. But when I come to places like this, I'm reminded that it doesn't all have to go in one direction, that we can turn things around. This profusion of life, all pouring into a place the moment the pressure is off and nature is allowed to do its own thing, and boom, you get this explosion of wildlife.
Rewilding projects like this offer hope for the world. We can reverse ecological collapse. Until now, farming has been essential to human survival. But I believe we're about to leave the agricultural age. We're going to see one of the biggest disruptions in human history, and it might just save us from catastrophe.